you?
Fine, thank you.
How's day one going?
Awesome.
I know, packed, right? But awesome. I'm really happy to hear that. I'd love to get a temperature of who's in the room. Who has one license? Awesome. So you're all here for some high level conversation today. How many of you have one license and you're on top of your reporting?
Say that.
On top of your reporting. Fewer hands. You can come to my confession booth anytime. Some of our member publishers are in the room this afternoon. I would love to invite them up. Kelly from Simply Liturgical Music, Alec Harris from GIA. Is there anyone else in the room? Okay, great. I'd love to invite you up to our microphone here. Say a few words. Say hello.
Hi. Hi, my name is Kelly Barth. I am the owner and founder of Simply Liturgical Music. We're a new company. We're only 2 years old. But working with One License has been amazing. We were fortunate. The merge happened right as we were starting. So we've only had to work with one company. But I can't emphasize enough, your reporting helps our composers so much. We are a little different. We're not a publisher. We're helping composers to self-publish their music. And the fact that we can give them a check from One License to say, hey, here's some more royalties, just makes their day. It's such a blessing. So your recording does count. It does add up, and our composers, thank you for it.
Thanks, I appreciate it.
Hi, my name is Alec Harris, and I'm president of GIA Publications, and just so happy that you're here, that you have licenses, that you're here to learn more. And as he said, the reporting is a really critical piece, because that's how royalties get paid out to all of the composers. And amazingly, we had, I think in the last 6 month period, 1.4 million songs reported on our service song usage in a 6 month period. Wow. So it's fantastic, and we pride ourselves on that. So your participation in that makes a big difference. So thank you, and thanks for your participation.
Thanks, Ellie. Well, if you're just joining us again, my name is Brenna Cronin. Thank you so much for being here. For those of you who like a roadmap, I'm gonna give you an overview of the next 40 minutes together. I promise to get you out on time into dinner. We'll do an overview of the website for about 10 minutes or so. So for those of you who are already familiar, it'll be a good refresher for you. And then we'll move into the bulk piece of what we're talking about today, which is supplemental hymnals and file sharing. And then we'll have some time for some extended questions and answers at the end. So as you have questions along, if you want to make a little note, and we can come back to those. If it's on the topic, great. If it isn't on the topic but is on license, great. If it's not on the topic at all, you can visit me at my booth anytime you want. So One License offers copyright reprints of congregational music. What that means is that we're primarily a reporting service and secondarily a downloading service. So all of the publishers that are here, they work with us, but they work with us for varying levels of participation. So some of them you may just see the data for reporting, some of them you may see a downloadable image, some of them you may see linked up to their hymnals and searchable and all that jazz. Varying levels of participation means that there are various levels of what you see on the website. So primarily a reporting service, secondarily a downloading service. We have three different time frames of licenses in terms of the actual length of time that they are. So our annual licenses is for a full year. We have those for churches, other organizations too, funeral homes, religious communities, retreat centers, etc., anybody who's using sacred music. We also then have the option to add podcast streaming onto your license as well. That gives you the ability to stream your services or to host the actual length of like the video, the YouTube video, for example, and put it on your social media. There's all kinds of great ways that you can interact with your congregation and with your general community because of those licenses. We also have a school license, so that's based on student enrollment. So it's different, the annual license based on average weekly attendance, so you want to be mindful. It's probably less than your registered families, right? What attendance actually is, turns out to be. So with the student enrollment, that's a kind of a more hard number in terms of enrollment. The single use licenses, those are good for 24 hours, wedding, funeral, even Christmas Eve into Christmas Day, right? Still 24 hours that you can use it for that. If you have an event that's happening on site, that's a little kind of like far exceeding what you already do. So, for For example, many of you, you're very, very high-level music directors. You may be asked to help plan a different event. I know the event for Father Solanus Casey at Ford Field, that needed its own separate license because it was beyond the scope of what just the local church was planning. So things like that to be mindful of. And then an event license, NPM is a really great example of that. They have a 7-day license with us that gives the permission to all this music that we're hearing right next to us. I'll just call it out so that way you don't have to be distracted by it. The practice track license, that gives you the ability to make copies of either CDs. So if you buy a CD, for example, from the GIA booth and you want to make a copy of the CD for your choir or for your cantor to learn from, you can use that master recording. You can also make your own copy as well. So there's a way to do a commercial or a non-commercial recording. So you can sit at your piano and you can play out a tenor part, and then the tenors can learn that based off of the practice track license. So all of these things, you report your usage for all of these different types of licenses. I'll direct your attention to our blog as well. It's news.onelicense.net. You can search for everything you need on here. So if you heard me say practice track for the first time and you didn't know what that was, search the word practice track on my blog and you'll be able to find a tutorial resource for it. So the member publisher page I'll direct you to. We work with about 160 different member publishers and their divisions. You heard from Kelly and Alec just a few minutes ago. So this page here is searchable, so you can filter the publishers based on your region. So for example, if we're looking for OCP, you'll see that filter. Also, you can search for their different categories as well. So if I was to type in New Dawn, that'll come up as well. So you can see exactly who we cover. If the member publisher is listed here, you have permission to reprint their music as long as you have a license in force. So if you're taking a look at a hymnal and you're looking at the bottom copyright information, if the copyright holder is a member publisher with our service, you have permission to reprint the music as long as you report your usage. All right, still with me? Okay. This overview might even be shorter because you're just so responsive, so thank you. The blog overview, I want to just mention a quick little thing here on this search bar in the upper right-hand corner. Log out of here. So you can see it a little bit better. When you click on the search bar, you can type in really anything that you're looking for. So if you're looking for webinar resources, you can type in webinar and see our group license webinar here. We just launched group licenses earlier this year officially. The 2019 new user webinar would be a really great resource for those of you who aren't super familiar with One License, and if I'm talking too fast or too, you know, overwhelmingly for you today, you can take a look at that. And then you can also look at webinar trainings for our podcast streaming license as well. That all might be a super helpful kind of deep dive. Make a note of that when you go home. That website, again, is news, N-E-W-S, just put the word news in front of our website, onelicense.net, and you'll be able to find everything that you need. So moving on to the topic of supplemental hymnals and file sharing. So this is the third installment of our One License series that we've offered here at NPM every summer. This is the third one. So since the creation of what we know as One License, we've offered a highly specialized session allowing myself, my team, to be able to educate you on kind of a broader level topic. So that's why this year we're focusing on supplemental hymnals, file sharing, and copyright, all in an effort to take your license to the next level. So I have some copies of a supplemental hymnal that I made. I'll also have it up on the screen, but what I'm gonna do is just kind of pass it out to each row and you can pass it on down and pass it on back. You'll have the next, you know, half hour or so to take a look through it, but it will be up on the screen as well. So give me just a second to pass those out. There you are. You can pass them back when you're done too. Thank you, I really appreciate that. So I'll direct your attention to this blog post. If you type in the word supplemental, we have a post called Supplemental Hymnals and Reusable Songbooks. So all of the information that we're talking about today is also found here on this blog post, so that way you can find it. The student parish at my University of Michigan made a great use of this supplemental hymnal concept, and I'm sure plenty of you have made use of this concept as well. So the example that I'm passing out for you, again, feel free to circle it around as you see fit, and we'll have it up on the screen. So while my parish had older hymnals, they still had a need to collect our other favorite songs and hymns that weren't found in those resources. So since no publication contains every last bit of music your congregation could possibly want to use, supplemental hymnals, reusable songbooks, any kind of official word you want to put on it is really what we're talking about here, this can be a really great option. You have to have an annual reprint license or a school reprint license in order to be able to have this resource. You have to have an ongoing license in order to keep something like this in force. Because the general idea is that you have this folder that you've created. Mine is rather unofficial, right? They're just folders bought at Target. But it's very easy to be able to say, hey everyone, take out your blue folder and turn to page 7. That's very clear, right? Especially if you have a hymnal like Ritual Song that's red, and then you have your blue hymnal, right? So you can make this as exciting, as simple as you want it to be. It can be as, you know, creative as you want to be too, but making sure that it's kind of a clear color is something that at least at my parish when I was younger, it worked out really well for us. So when you're considering if something like this would be a helpful resource for you or not, I want to bring to light a couple of different thoughts. And I'll remind you again that these are all written out in case you want to share this with your pastor or other decision makers. So first you want to decide among your worship, finance, and sustainability committees, do you have all three, of whether this is a good idea to invest in or not. So you want to consider questions like, will the initial investment of copy paper and time and planning pay off for you to be able to use it for a long amount of time? And I think it will. Do you have the time and energy from your secretarial staff, from music assistants, and perhaps students who are looking for confirmation service hours to make this happen? Also a good question. And is the project in line with our social ethical teachings to be green and reduce our carbon footprint? So those might all be great questions that you want to bring to a finance committee, a worship committee, or a sustainability committee as you start to ask these questions and see if it's a good idea. So I'll bring your attention to our list feature. I'm sure that plenty of you use this feature anyway, but it's a really great use for something like a supplemental hymnal. So under My Account and then Manage Lists, you'll see all of your lists pop up. So Community Songbook is the list that I have here, and you'll see all of the songs listed within the Community Songbook. So let's say you have 30 songs that are in the resource. All 30 can be on your list. That way you never have to find them again. They're all right there. The 30 songs are in the book. You're only going to sing one, two, maybe three of them on a weekend. So the one, two, or three are the ones that you report. Does that make sense? So you print the 30, you put the 30 on the list, but you only report the one or two that you're actually using. So be sure to invite feedback from a variety of different sources when you're thinking about what the list of music actually is. So will your high school youth group be using these during their Wednesday night services? That might be a good question if you serve that community. Are there enough options for the seasons if you want to use it year-round? That can also come into play with how you want to organize the hymnal. Maybe you want to have a section for Christmas, right? Instead of putting it alphabetically, maybe you have it divided based on the liturgical year. Are there favorite pieces of music or songs that resonate with your community specifically? You might want to consider having a poll on your website so that way the community really feels involved and engaged from the beginning of the project. Once the final list is decided, make sure to put that list under the Manage List tab, which is up on the screen here, and title your list after the name of the resource. So Community Songbook is what I've called it. I know some folks do like a seasonal supplemental hymnal. You can call it the Advent and Christmas Songbook, and then you'll be able to find your list more easily. Go ahead with your question.
How did you get to that page again?
Yeah, of course. Under My Account, Manage Lists. And from here, you can either create a new list or you can edit a list that you already have. Yeah, of course. If the member publisher has not provided a download, I mentioned earlier that there's varying levels of participation, and that's just the truth. So I'll just tell you the truth. Varying levels of participation. You can scan and insert an approved congregational reprint box or a version from an octavo or a hymnal that you already own. You can also type out the lyrics, or you can engrave it into a music notation software like Finale or Sibelius. All of that, again, is allowed as long as you have our annual or school reprint license.
Can you say that again?
Yeah, you're welcome to engrave the files yourself if the downloads aren't available. You're welcome to Xerox it from a hymnal resource that you have. You can pull it from the octavo that you've purchased from the publisher. All of that is allowed as long as once you have it in the resource, you're reporting what you're using.
Cool.
Okay.
That makes
again for you, so you can take a look at it. In terms of the reporting, it's pretty straightforward. I know some of you are very, very aware of how this works. But say By the Waters of Babylon is in my songbook. I'm going to click on that box there, and I'm going to click the green report button. I'm going to indicate the week that it's for, the number of services that I used it for, and I can either save and stay on my list, or I can save and I can view my report. You can also report all of them that are selected in case you want to go down and select more than one. So you have some options there. So I want to bring our attention to the resource itself. So if you still happen to have one of those resources, feel free to look at it. Otherwise, feel free to keep passing it. I'll pull it up on our screen. So I work in Google Docs. I don't know how many of you do. I just think it's the best, and they did not pay me to say that. It's just the best. You can edit files in real time, if you're not aware of that. If Kelly was on this document right now, I could see what his edits were. We can have a conversation on the document. It's great stuff. Also, my favorite feature is that you aren't saving Supplemental Hymnal version 4 BCC edits 6/22/19. Oh my goodness gracious, how many versions of documents are out there, right? So Google Docs is a great way to keep everything in place. So the first thing you want to do is decide on the format of the binding and the cover, and consider investing in cardstock or onto a laminated option. The formatting, so that's why the decision has to happen first, the formatting is going to affect your margins. So you want to be mindful of that. You're welcome to use a professional printer. They'll probably require some type of email from us saying that it's okay for you to do this. But you're allowed to do that. But you want to be mindful of what your margins are, so that way you can make sure that you're doing that in your actual creation of it. Spiral binding, staples, a pocket folder with brads, or a traditional glue and padding press are all great options for in-house production. All of those are legal. All of those are allowed. All of those are legal. All of them are allowed. It can look as fancy as you want it to look. It can have gold embossing on it. It can be as crazy as you want it to be. Cannot sell it. And I think you all know that. Cannot sell it. But it can be as fancy as you want it to be. For the cover, consider including the congregation name, a logo, or even hold an art contest. Talk about community engagement, one of my very, very favorite topics. This helps to engage your congregation on the design of the cover image. It asks for their buy-in. It helps them be able to say that they want to use that resource when they come to Mass on Sunday. If it's a seventh grade student that won the art contest, how proud is their family? And they're probably making a donation to cover the cost of the supplemental hymnals, right? There's lots of engagement that can happen around this type of process. Because again, I'm not gonna lie to you, it takes a lot of time and effort to put something like this together. A solid color, like I mentioned earlier, it makes for really easy reference with announcements. So inviting everyone to take out their red folder, their blue spiral, their green supplement, right? Whatever your parish color is, you can really highlight that here. Especially if the color of the supplement is different from your primary hymnal resource. So in terms of compiling the document, I mentioned Google Docs, the ability that you have to view and share files. So I want to give you kind of an overview of how I have it all spelled out here. So the first thing is this title page. We talked about having a community art contest, but you also know if you make worship aids, that you have lots of options for downloading free images, typically off the internet. Something like Pexels is going to be free, P-E-X-E-L-S. They didn't pay me to say that either. I just really like their website. Anything that's under copyright, you obviously have to get permission for, but you already know that because you come to the session. Of course, if the artwork has been created by somebody in your community, you just need their consent. But I encourage you to list a thank you to them on your acknowledgments page. I think that that's a really nice way to highlight all their work and their effort, and especially if they're a budding artist, to be able to engage them in that way. That's really important. Of course, have the name of your parish, maybe have the city if you'd like to. If you have a parish logo, you can do that too, but you can see the One License logo that's down there at the bottom. So be mindful of how you want to have your table of contents. You are welcome to have a parish mission statement on here. You can have a simple sentence that says, all are welcome to join in singing, something that feels really inviting. The table of contents can be alphabetical. It can be seasonal. It can be by popularity. Who's the judge of that? I don't know, right? But it can be organized in a variety of different ways. ways. And again, this really gives you the opportunity to be as creative as you want to be with the project. So my recommendation, we're going to take a look at the footer of the page here, is to include your reprint license information on the footer of every page. So that way it's just magically there when you add another page. Reprinted with permission under one license number A- or L- if you're a school, enter your number, and then all rights reserved. If you're a school, your license number begins with an L. If you're a church or other organization, it begins with an A. Keep in mind, as I mentioned earlier, that you must keep your license in force in order to be able to use the supplemental hymnal. The second that your license is no longer being paid for, it's got to be destroyed. Okay? Make sure to include all relevant copyright information for each selection on each page. So this includes the title, the composer, the author names, publisher, copyright holder name, and copyright year. So for example, if we're looking at something like All Are Welcome, you'll see the title at the top, and then at the bottom, as a part of the image, GIA has already included that for you, right? Under no circumstances, and if I click on this, you can see that it's an image, that should not be cropped out. The only reason why it would need to be cropped out is if you needed to retype it for some reason, if the font was too big or anything. But the image itself, yes, I saw your hand motions, the image itself can be big or smaller, you can decide how it fits on the page. Something like this that's really long, it's going to take up the entirety of a page. I'll show you a mask setting in just a second. But in terms of that copyright information, it's already included in the image, so please keep it there.
Can you pause for one?
Yeah.
So if you were going to put the titles, the composer name and the, all the other copyright information more under the title, that's if, as long as you include that, that's okay.
It is.
You can crop it out for that reason. Mm-hmm. Even though, because they have some extra information sometimes down there, like the birth date of the birth year of the composer or something like that.
So I would argue that anything that the publisher has included should be kept, because they've included that for a reason.
Okay, so even from a hymnal that, okay.
Yeah, yeah, they've included, if for whatever reason they thought it was appropriate and important to include it. It could be copyright law, it could be their specific style.
But this was just to make me feel old.
It's not to make me feel old.
Well, it could be that.
No, Silent Night should make us all feel old, but certainly not All Are Welcome.
Thank you.
Another example, all that is hidden, it's really long, it's going to take up its own page, right? I'll show you this mask setting. So the Gloria, the title of it is not included in the image. So you see how I have the image highlighted? So I've added that it's the Gloria, and more importantly on top of that, I've indicated that it's the Mass of St. Anne. I've also bolded it. So what you can do here is have, you know, your entire Mass setting listed all together. You can have the Mass of St. Anne, you can have the Mass of Joy and Peace, right? They can all be together in whatever way makes the most sense for you. But still, you see Ed Boldick's name, it's part of this image, right? And this is a great example. I cropped this because the music was here and his copyright information was down here, and I didn't want all that wasted space. So I copied it and pasted it into, I made it closer is essentially what I did. I highly recommend, if this is something that's super resonating with you and making sense, that you use TIFF files, T-I-F or T-I-F-F, not PDF files. PDF files have a lot of margin on the side of them and you have to crop them out. So by the time you crop it and drag it and drop it and send it to your printer, they're going to say this is super blurry and you can't work with this image. TIFF images are gigantic. They can go on billboards. They can go on little tiny pencils that you all took, right? TIFF images are they have a lot of flexibility to them.
Is there a rhyme or reason why some are offered under TIFF and some are the GIF?
GIF GIF is how OCP has indicated that they want to use their files. Again, varying levels of participation.
So clear.
I know. Yep. That's what they do, but they work in the same way.
Sometimes the TIFF ones are just getting a lot of
Yeah, and the PDFs are worse. The PDFs have a lot of space on the side of them. Yeah. Of course, and again, you're welcome to, you know, if you have the time and energy and a cup of coffee in front of you, to get into your finale or Sibelius program and kind of be reiterated. Yeah.
So in these mass settings, I've noticed that you put the text and the composer under each piece of the mass setting. So you shouldn't just do it at the end, like if you've got your mass on, you know, facing pages, for example, and it's the holy and the memorial affirmation.
Sure.
Can you just add all of that at the end, or does it need to be with each section?
So that's a great question, and I'm not sure that there's a specific need for it to be one way or the other, as long as it's something.
Right.
A similar question to compare. to? Does your one license number need to be on everything, or can it just be at the end? It's kind of the same thing. I want to see the number somewhere. Ed Bolden, if he comes and visits your parish, wants to see his name somewhere, right? So you can indicate on the first page, Mass of St. Anne, pages 3 and 4, copyright Ed Bolden, 2011, WLP, text 2010, ISIL, and then just have the images together if you want to. But it should be clear that this, these pages belongs to that. Yeah, it should be clear. Yes, I didn't say no. Well, and I think part of the reason, I mean, if we're being super honest with each other here, I think part of the reason is because we see it missing so often that I just want to make your life easier. So if it is at the bottom of the image, great. If it's at the end of the section, great. You'll notice NPM puts it at the very, very, very end, right? So there's lots of options. I want to remove any barrier to access. Equity is something that's really important to me personally, okay? We're here to educate. So you can see, if we go a little bit further down, that I have some options, page 7 and beyond. Of course, continued music you can have here, a section for seasonal favorites, community prayers if you want to include those as well, or a parish mission statement. Hymn text may be commissioned for the parish or written by parishioners. That can be a really beautiful thing to include as well. The inclusion of dialogues and texts of the Mass, including the Nicene Creed, the preface dialogue, responses, etc. Words from the third edition of the Roman Missal are permitted to be reprinted without charge, reporting or permissions, all right? You can also include a thank you page to your selection community, your selection committee, excuse me, or maybe donors to your project, and again, that mentioned earlier for that artwork that we talked about. So this can really act like a living, breathing thing that can be edited and added to. So your last page doesn't need to be, a thank you, come again. Right? The last page can just be music, so you can continue to add music again in the future. So maybe the acknowledgments page goes on the second page, right? Maybe that doesn't change, but as time goes on, you want to add more resources. You can open up the brads of the folders, service hours, right? That sounds like a great project. And put the pages on there. Yes?
On the Mass part, mm-hmm. you still have to show acknowledgments even though you don't have to pay for anything?
Yes.
Yeah, that's one thing a lot of people leave them off.
Yes. Yeah, always. I better safe than sorry, but yes. Yeah. So next step in the process would be to proofread your final product. So this also includes inviting key stakeholders to offer their thoughts as well. So don't send it to the printer without those key stakeholders taking a look at it, right? Committee, pastor, decision makers, things like that. You want to make sure that if you're creating something, and again, this is going to take so much time, but it's going to be beautiful once it's done. I'm not trying to scare you with the time, it's just the truth. You're going to email me and say, Brenna, that took 70 hours, why didn't you tell me? Maybe not 70 hours, but you know. Some 70 hours. You're like, yes, I just did this. And then you're ready to begin the printing process. Of course, you can always email it to us and we're happy to take a look at it too. When it's time to place them in the worship space, and this is where the piano would begin with like really soft, lovely music if someone was here, you should invite the committee and those who participated to help put them in the pews, right? What if, I know you're like, yeah, right, they'll never come. But like, what a beautiful act of participation and of community, right? You can have a little lunch for them. It's the completion of this project, and then you can take a vacation. If you decided to engage the cover artist, be sure to give that person credit for their work, but also build up community morale and buy-in of the resource with maybe a special prayer at Mass or a kickoff party, right? There's lots of different ways that you can do it. It is important to remember that you must use the One License tools to report the music you used from the supplement each week. So again, you have the 30 pages, but then you report the 1, 2, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 that you use. You want to know the frequency that you used each song as well. Your default services can be changed in your profile. So for example, if you have 5 masses, 4 of them are in English, 1 of them is in Spanish, your default might be 4, not 5, right? So the default is going to multiply the number of services that you have. So I would make your default the consistency of which the music is the same. So if you have 5 masses, I'm seeing some faces, so I'll describe it again. If you have 5 masses, one's a Spanish mass, one's a teen mass, maybe they're doing different music, show up for three, and then you're going to report something else for the team mass, something else for the Spanish mass, the guitar mass, etc. Yeah, so under my account, my profile, default settings, services. Did I just blow someone's mind?
But you can change it each week.
Yep. But to have the default, it's going to save you just 1 second at a time. Yeah. So for planning purposes, you're able to report 12 weeks in the past and then 6 weeks into the future. So again, keep in mind that this extended use of a booklet or a hymnal supplement is valid only as long as your license is in force. All right. So I promised an extended Q&A, so here we are. Thank you for your questions throughout, but please, happy to answer anything you've got. Melody line of All Are Welcome, because that's what the congregation is singing anyway, and that's what the choir
choir? Yes, right? Are we going to give you a hard time about that? No. Can you reprint an octavo? No.
Right.
So with the children's choirs, it's kind of the same idea. They're singing Silent Night just like everybody else. That's public domain, but you know, they're singing Silent Night just like everybody else. Go ahead and make them a copy of it and record it for use.
So, but that's the thing. So I have to, like, say it's Gatherison.
Yep.
They're leading the congregation. I've made 12 copies.
Yep.
For them. I record that for use at one mass, basically.
Yes.
Because the
congregation's participating, right?
From their hymnals.
Sure. But they're still participating in it, so I would record it.
Just
because you made copies for the choir, that's why.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm not sure that anybody's going to ever get to the business of having a children's choir license. I mean, you know, assume best intentions,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, but if everyone's singing out of their hymnals, but you made copies for the choir.
Just because they can't find the page.
Exactly. Yeah. I would just record it. Better safe than sorry.
That's true.
Yes.
Yeah.
We have a few more minutes. What other questions are there? Okay, let's take a big deep breath in. And a big exhale. Thank you so much for your time today. I hope you have a fantastic rest of your week. I'm here until Thursday afternoon if you have any other questions. Otherwise, I'll be checking all of your recording histories and emailing you appropriately. Have a great day.
I'm making appointments for confessions.
And I'm making appointments for confessions.